So, hello everyone. I'm Mark Farrell. I'm a second year student at the University of Waterloo up in Waterloo, Ontario, Canada. And today I'm going to be talking about Typed Racket. Typed Racket adds an optional static type system to Racket, allowing you to ensure that some aspects of your program's behavior are correct before they run. Now, Typed Racket's designed to accommodate the style in which you'd program an untyped racket and use your untyped racket programs in Typed Racket with minimal modification. Typed Racket achieves this by equipping its type system with a number of features, notably occurrence typing, which allows you to derive types from predicate tests inside the body of a definition. So untyped racket programmers would write functions where you might say, if x, your input, is a string, then do this, or if it's a number, then do that. That's just what they do. So occurrence typing accommodates the style of programming. That leads me to my next point. Typed Racket also has untagged union types, so you can have like the union of a string or a number, and the inhabitants of that type could be either be string or numbers. And if you had a function if x is a string, does one thing, and if it's a number, does another thing, then the type of that definition would be, the function would reduce the union of a string or a number. Typed Racket also has subtyping, having any as the top type, nothing as the bottom type, and for instance, real as a subtype of number. And lastly, it makes all values types, because like what you might do sometimes is say that if x is a valid input to your function, then do something and produce some value, or else produce exactly the symbol error, which would be a value, so they make all values types. We'll have a look at these particular features that help you, that make it so that you can use your untyped racket programs and typed racket with minimal modification later on this workshop, but first let's get you using typed racket, type annotating examples of previously untyped racket code. Perhaps looking at some more familiar features of Typed Racket's type system. As a show of hands, how many of you have already downloaded and installed Racket and Dr. Racket? So you're all good. And Racket 6.1.1, the latest one on the website? Okay. And how many of you have not? Sorry. Okay. Now would be a good time to do so. It might take you a couple minutes. We'll just go over some basic examples. For instance, type annotating the definition of a person's full name. Here, John Smith. So we want John Smith to be a string, and string is a basic type in Typed Racket, so you just type open parentheses. So to type annotate this definition of, we know that John Smith is a string, but we want to make sure that John Smith is a string before our program runs, so we just type annotate this definition by saying that full name is a string. It's a basic type in Typed Racket, and you change the language from Racket to Typed Racket, and hit run, and you just, run is in Dr. Racket's button up at the top right corner. Yeah, and so if you type full name at the interpreter here, you could see that it's a string. Okay, so suppose this person's age is 28, for the sake of an example. Any thoughts on how you might type annotate that? First of all, how many of you are familiar with Racket? Not Typed Racket, but just Racket. Okay. Any thoughts on how you might type annotate this definition based on what you know about types and I hate saying untyped racket, dynamically typed racket, yeah. Based on what you know about like Racket's numeric types, like. It does. It's so yeah. You could say that age is a number, and that would be correct. I was expecting that some of you might say that age is an integer. More precisely, you could say that age is a positive integer. There's, I believe, on the Racket manuals, there's a diagram explaining Racket's numeric type hierarchy. I'm not saying it's nice. I'm just saying that like you pay attention to that. Like you could be most precise by saying that age is a positive integer rather than integer or number, and it uses subtyping. So like number is a subtype. Integer is a subtype of number, and positive integer is a subtype of integer. All right. So okay, now we're going to look at some function definitions in Typed Racket.
So what would you call it? Positive integer?
Positive, yeah. You could say that age is a positive integer. And that would be most precise with in Racket's numeric types, yeah. How many of you have gotten that far? Okay.
So sorry, if you in the console, is there a way that you can query? Oh right, if I just type age, I see. It tells me what it is.
Yeah, there's. You could print type age and just get its type. And if you have a type, which we'll see later on, like if you say, you could say, what's the type of number? It'll tell you that number is exactly the union of all of these subtypes. So let's type a GC. Let's look at how we might type functions in Typed Racket. Suppose we have a GCD function that computes the greatest common divisor of A and B. We can implement this function using modulo. Now, this function works for all integer inputs. Oh, sorry, your question?
What are the square brackets?
The square brackets, that's just a convention. Everything's just, yeah, all you have is S expressions in Racket, but you don't need that. It does it for you in Dr. Racket, because that's the convention, but if you just did this in a text editor, you could just use the round parentheses, and that would be fine. Yeah? Though don't do that. Use the square braces in con, because that's just the convention, yeah? Now, you could type annotate this function by just saying it's a function type that takes an integer, and gives you an integer, because it works for all integers, including negative integers. For instance, the GCD of negative 3 and 4 is 1, and that would be fine. But suppose we, let's call that GCD 1. You can also implement GCD only using subtraction. And if you implement GCD with only subtraction, that's a problem, because if you give this function negative integers as inputs, it won't terminate. You couldn't take the GCD of negative 3 and 4 in this case.
Can you explain the bracketing in this definition?
Sure.
I'm not following the logic exactly.
Oh, my bad. Sorry, I think I have an extra set of parentheses here, yeah?
Okay.
Does that, are you okay now?
Yeah.
Okay.
You said the bracket's a convention, it's equivalent to the parentheses, but, so what, when should you use a bracket, and what is the convention?
Just with cond.
Okay.
Notably cond, yeah.
Okay.
Cond,
so
match.
Each clause in cond.
Is this, you should use the square brackets.
Okay. Note
that Dr. Racket should be doing that for you, yeah? You shouldn't be able to type, I don't think it did it. Perhaps not. Perhaps it doesn't do it for you, but you should use the square parentheses there. You don't have to though. Don't worry about it, I guess. Yeah. Okay. So this GCD function won't terminate if you give it negative integers, unlike the previous GCD function that we looked at that was implemented using modulo. So you want to enforce the constraint that it, you can only give it non-negative integers as input.
Another question. Here, in this definition, you use else, whereas in the previous implementation, GCD1, you didn't use else there. What distinguishes when you should do one or the other?
That's just, like, they're just two implementations of GCD. You can implement GCD using...
I'm referring specifically to your use of else in the con.
Okay.
Some of us probably don't come from any schema racket background.
So what will happen is if, like, you don't have an else clause and you reach that else clause, like, if you don't satisfy, like, the... Oh, sorry, that should be else GCD B modulo AB, yeah? Yeah. But yeah, if you don't have an else clause and you reach the end of your clauses and you don't have a clause to handle a particular case of input, then it will throw an error at runtime. Anyway, you'd want to enforce the constraint here that GCD takes non-negative integers as input, and in untyped racket, you could use contracts to guard the function at runtime. So if you give it non-negative integers as input, it would throw an error.
I'm sorry, did you say that the contract is something that is a feature of untyped racket?
Yeah, so in untyped racket, you can guard functions by saying that, like, specifying what's valid input, and if you don't give it a valid input, it'll throw an error at runtime. So you can diagnose where in your program you're not meeting specification, but you can only diagnose where it's happening at runtime. You can only guard functions themselves. It's not like transitive, like type checking. Yeah. So you could say that this function has to take an exact non-negative integer, an exact non-negative integer, and give you an exact non-negative integer.
So is that specifying runtime
type? Yeah. So, like, you actually, these should be predicates. So you'd say it would test that A is an exact non-negative integer, an exact non-negative integer, and B is an exact non-negative integer, and that it has to give you an exact non-negative integer. So. Yeah, so for example, like you do a lot of, like as I said, dispatch by predicate testing in racket. And so for example, when you define your own structs in untyped racket, say a position, like an XY coordinate, it would, and you say like struct posin XY, and you create that, define that struct, then it also creates a predicate posin to test that something's of the type posin at runtime. So exact non-negative integer is a numeric type in type racket. For example, like 3.0 is not an exact non-negative integer. However, like it would be a non-negative integer. That's how racket treats types. But yeah, like I personally feel as though type racket's numeric type system is not, like, I think we've gotten farther than that in programming. Like, but that's the way it works. Yeah. So you can't take like the GCD of -3 or 4. You get a contract error. However, if we try to enforce the same constraint in type racket and enforce that constraint before our program runs, we run into the issue of having to actually cast the result of subtraction in this definition, even if we think it's correct. Even if we know our program's correct, we still have to cast, yeah, coerce types. So if we want to say that GCD takes a exact non-negative integer, exact non-negative integer, see an exact non-negative integer. You can't say that, even if we know this is correct, you can't say that when we subtract negative b from a in these two cases that it's an exact non-negative integer, even though if we know that if we give, that it will be for all exact non-negative integers that we give to this function. So we have to cast to an exact non-negative integer.
define is obvious, but I'm not sure what it means when you say colon, and then the mention of colon as the first thing in the list.
That's a type annotation. So you say that Type Racket like adds a type system to rackets with the idea is that you might, for instance, like you could do this in comments, like untyped racket programmers kind of comment types like this with this convention, like colon, GCD, like function type, exact non-negative integer, exact non-negative integer. But in type racket, it's like you could uncomment that and then it will type check, yeah?
Oh.
Yeah.
The comment's been converted to something that the compiler or interpreter or whatever it is actually checks for you.
Yeah, so this is kind of like the syntax here for type annotations. It's kind of like this convention that people have been doing in comments for quite some time, at least in my first year coursework. Like they'd actually make us like comment type annotations in this convention. And like since Racket's educational, like kind of an educational teaching language, it's like, hey, look, you know, you did your first course, now we're in our second course. Now we could start uncomment, like these are types, let's introduce you to the idea of types, let's uncomment your comments and then type check. Yeah. Yeah, so like the contract syntax is a little bit different, though. You're saying that, yeah, it's a function, like this arrow means it's a function type that takes the type exact non-negative integer A, the exact non-negative integer A, and will produce an exact non-negative integer A.
Is the arrow something that
Type
Racket added or something that
appropriate? Yeah, it's Type Racket syntax for a function type, yeah.
Just one other question. So that sort of syntax is standard in Haskell because everything is queried by default.
Yeah.
Is that the case in Racket?
Not really. I don't. It's not queried. It's just. You can query functions in Racket, but I don't think that's the idea. It's just.
But they just put it that way.
This is just the function type syntax. Yeah, it's not queried by default. Yeah.
I'm sorry. Since we mentioned comments, what is the comment character for?
Colon. Yeah.
Okay.
So you have to cast this to exact non-negative integers.
That's just an ordinary, that's an unsafe cast.
Yeah, it's an unsafe cast. We know it's correct. We don't want to be able to give this function negative integers input because it won't terminate. So this is the best we can do to say that GCD takes an exact non-negative integer and exact non-negative integer gives you an exact non-negative integer. And you can't use contracts with types in type racket for one thing, like meaning you can enforce some constraints at compile time and enforce some constraints at runtime. You can't do that. For one thing, I mean, as you mentioned there, like the syntax is similar for how you'd express function contracts and how you'd express function types. So we can't, there's already kind of, there might be some way to, in principle, use contracts with types to enforce some constraints at compile time and some at runtime. However, we can't do that right now. We just can't do that right now in Racket. Yeah.
Question. I'm trying to follow along by typing in two. Define contract seems to only be in Racket. And
that's true. Yeah. You can't use contracts.
Two different
files? Those are two different files. I actually did contracts first here, and then changed it to type bracket and then showed you how this is how you do it in contracts and then this is how we type it. Yeah.
Okay.
Go from contracts to static types.
Contract, but it says language type bracket, so that's actually an error, right? In terms of running.
It was originally racket when I showed the contract and like the contract error here.
She's been jumping back and forth right before our eyes just to keep us
right
on our toes. But
it's really hard to try to follow along and do what you're doing.
And you're going very quickly and assuming a lot of knowledge.
When you're in Racket, you'd probably say, now I'm in Racket, now I'm in Type Racket, because I'm trying to type this in too and follow along so I learn something.
Okay. Do you want me to go back? Or?
No. Now I know what's going on.
Okay, so, yeah.
Here's just a general conceptual thing about the application. I'm going to make sure I've got this right. Everything you type up in the top is if it's a file, and if we hit run, it's going to process everything that's in the upper section. Completely, it's not like it's evaluating line by line. It just processes everything up there, and is that right?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Yeah, so we have to cast here, and then we can't, for instance, give it a negative integer as input, because that's negative 3 doesn't have the type of exact non-negative integer. So we guard from being able to do that. So if we use programs that use GCD, it won't type check, and we won't be able to run our program if you try to take the GCD of some negative number anywhere. Yeah? OK.
I have a question. If we know that the cast is always going to be bad, but suppose there's an error in the program and it comes out a negative integer, what would happen?
Sorry, so if you won't be able to run your program if you try to take the GCD of a negative integer anywhere in your program before running it?
No, I mean, in the cast line, suppose I had B and A inverted there, so it would actually be negative inside the cast. What would happen in that case?
I'm not sure. I think...
So I did that.
You did. So there'll be a contract error at runtime, yeah? Yeah. So we can't guard against that before our program runs then in that case. But I believe this is the best we could do if we want to try to enforce the constraint that our GCD function only can't take non-negative integers input.
I tried to run that and it said cast is unbound.
Cast is unbound. Are you in typed racket? Pound lang?
In racket.
Oh, yeah. You have to change your language to typed racket.
Oh, OK. I lost.
Yeah. Yeah, so like the idea is like we're type annotating, we're going from racket to typed racket, and I'm just showing you how you type annotate previously untyped racket code to enforce constraints before your program runs. Okay, so as an exercise, how would you type annotate a function that computes the nth Fibonacci number? I'll give you like 2 minutes to do that. How many of you have fully?
Is there any documentation you can look at for the types that are built in the
bracket? There's the type bracket guide.
When I move the cursor to a type, it shows something in the top right corner as an arrow you can see there. Okay. And if I click on that arrow, it sends me to the site of the types.
Right.
Just like look at what we just did with the GCD function. Like the GCD function, it takes two exact non-negative integers as input and gives you an exact non-negative integer as output. Just using what we did there and what we did with age in the previous example, like exploring basic types, how much you type annotate this Fibonacci function. Like this, are you all familiar with the Fibonacci sequence? Like this would take like one and give you one, two and give you two, and whatever the next element in the Fibonacci sequences, yeah. Are those of you who didn't download and install Racket before this workshop, are you good now, or you're good?
What's your Wi-Fi?
I'm on Eduroam, so I'm able to use the same login that I use at other universities, I guess through North America, yeah.
Yeah.
Once you pass the agree, then you've got the connectivity.
Oh, cool. As a show of hands, how many of you think you know how to type annotate this function or have successfully done it? You're good. OK. Do you want to give an answer?
I have it being a function from a natural or a positive integer.
A natural? Did that type check? Is that? Oh, in the fib function?
Yeah,
yeah. That's the idea I was going for. Like, you can give the Fibonacci function negative integers as input, and it will terminate. But we want the Fibonacci sequence to start at one as input. So like, you should do something similar. I'd actually say that this function's type signature should take a positive integer, and give you a positive integer. but you have to cast. You could, that's a design decision you'd have to make. Like, since fib will terminate for negative numbers as input, you could just say that it takes an integer and gives you an integer. I'm saying, like, you could still be more precise with by saying it's a positive integer because you want that to start at 1, but you have to cast. And that, like with GCD, you have to cast. And I think that's the best we can do with typed racket right now.
Before doing any of the type checking stuff, I just typed in what you had, and it gets an error saying there's a type mismatch, even though there's no types mentioned at all.
Yeah, I think I made a mistake where I didn't say fib twice. I tried to apply fib to two arguments rather than doing plus fib of n minus one. And
oh, yeah, I see. Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. Apologize. Yeah. Yeah.
Can you be more precise than positive integer, like bounded to a certain number, like to a dot?
Yeah, we'll get to that though, but that not in this example. I don't think it's relevant for this example. That's sort of where I'm going, so that's good. Yeah.
Why? It's kind of because like the other positive integer, depending on your memory constraint, can overflow.
Yeah, you could.
You want either to have an unlimited integer representation or like bounded to what you have.
Yeah, I'm actually going to show you something cool, how we might add like Ada-inspired range types to type brackets, saying that here's my type for a person's age. It has to be between 16 and 80. We're going to, like, when we look at record types with students, like, I'm going to say, like, a student has an ID, name, age, faculty, and term, and we only want their ID to be between certain positive integers and their age to be being, say, 16 and 80 for the sake of an example. And let me get to that. Yeah. Okay. So are you all good here? Okay. So now we're going to look at record types in typed racket. Record types are like product types where each field has a name. In typed racket, they're called structs. You could have structs in untyped racket as well, but they only know about them at racket only knows about them at runtime. So let's begin by, as I mentioned, like looking at this structure for this record type for a hypothetical student. So in untyped racket, you could say that this student has a field for their age, name, I mean their ID, name, age, faculty, and term. And
so we're back in just racket.
We're back in just racket, and I want to show you how we're creating this record type for student.
Is it possible to have just type bracket, not bracket, type bracket? Because I'm trying to put my head around two different things.
I suppose,
What would be the best way for someone who is fairly new to racket, except not have the need to go to racket, but to start with the notion of types itself and how it's implemented in racket? Would that be something?
I'm not sure. The theme for my workshop is how we go from untyped racket, where it's difficult to enforce constraints. We certainly can't enforce any constraints about our, like, we have some software specifications. We can't enforce those constraints in our specification before our program runs. And I'm just showing how you'd go from untyped racket, where you can't enforce those constraints, at least before your program runs. You can get kind of far with contracts, but not that far, and how we add types to enforce those constraints before our program runs. So I'm not, yeah. I think ideally if this were in a classroom, then the audience would best be somebody who took like one CS course that taught Scheme, and then we're introducing types in their second course or something like that. I'm not sure how else to teach types, yeah. So as an example here, we could create record types in untyped racket, and we could create a student at runtime and say that their ID is an error, for example, that their name is 2, that their age is Mark, that their faculty is nonsense, that their term is 6A, that they're in 6A, which isn't a, which doesn't make sense if you're a graduate student, an undergrad, and you only have 8 terms. So you can grade all these, you can grade these invalid students at runtime and untyped racket and can't enforce those constraints that we talked about. How if we switch over to typed racket, we can for one enforce the constraints that we'll start by enforcing the constraints for faculty and term. As I mentioned, like you have untagged union types and all types are values and typed racket, those are features of a type system. So what you can do is you can define a type for faculty, for instance, and say that faculty is the untagged union of the mathematics symbol, science, engineering, arts, or applied health sciences. Try to break that up.
Does typed racket require you to type everything?
Yes. No. So, yes and no. So, as I mentioned, you can use a lot of previously untyped racket programs and typed racket and it will try to infer types wherever it can. It equips its type feature with its type system with the features that I mentioned to make it so that there's as little friction as possible when going from untyped racket to typed racket. That's not necessarily good, because if your design is flawed originally in untyped racket, or if you have some, if it doesn't meet some specification that you set, even though you believe it does, just adding types that just compensate for that that incorrect code doesn't do much. But the idea is that, like, to have little friction to be able to reuse the tools that people built in untyped racket when going to typed racket, which is safer, which is hypothetically safer if you go from incorrect design and correct your design with types, though since you can use untyped racket code oftentimes in typed racket, it will infer types about your untyped racket code, which could be incorrect. That's not necessarily good. But I guess that's sort of the theme of gradual typing, to add types, gradually enforce constraints and catch errors, and with little friction and still being able to use your previously untyped racket code, your untyped code as much as possible. And
I think I noticed when you changed it over to typed racket, that struct, it immediately popped up an error at the bottom saying that ID needed a type, and I wasn't quite sure why that was. In other words, before you did the faculty thing and you change it from racket to typed racket, there was an error at the bottom complaining about ID saying that it didn't have a type. So I wasn't clear on what the rules were when it would insist that you type it.
For structs, you need a type. And for instance, if you had an untyped racket module with student in it that's untyped and you wanted to use it in a typed racket module, that would be a case where you have to say what the types of each field are in your struct. There are many cases where you don't have to do that, but there are some cases where you do. And with like structs, that would be a case where you do.
So
yeah.
Typed racket generally, it says if you have a struct, then you have to type.
Yeah.
Struct members.
It tries to minimize friction and let you use untyped racket code and typed racket and have that previously untyped racket code type check as much as possible. It just minimizes friction. Like, there's still cases where you have to explicitly type annotate your previously untyped racket code. So if we have this type for faculty, and I mentioned we want to ensure that, like, our student's term is valid as well.
I just tried to run that in typed racket, and it said type name used out of context in union.
In union. Oh, define type, sorry. It should be define type, yeah. Don't run it yet, though, because we haven't typed the struct. Yeah. So I don't think it'll type check. So we can, like, for instance, when we do type annotate the student, we say that, for instance, that their ID will be our ID type. We want their name to be a string. Their age to be a valid age, their faculty to be a valid faculty, and their term to be a valid term. But like what we did here with faculty, like we can enforce the constraint that their faculty is valid by saying it's either the symbol mathematics, science, engineering, art, or applied health sciences. Nothing else is a valid faculty. But as I mentioned, the only valid terms in an undergraduate's career might be 1A, 1B, 2A, 2B, 3A, 3B, 4A, and 4B. So thoughts on how you might create this type for term to enforce that constraint, similar to how we did it with faculty? Yeah?
A union of symbols?
A union of symbols, yeah. The union of symbols for 1A, 1B, 2A, 2B, and so on and so forth. Now, the forcing the like we already said that name is a string, so we don't need to do anything there. Now, enforcing the constraint that their ID and age is valid, we want the age to be only between positive integers in the range 0 to 99,999,999, and we want valid students in their undergraduate career to only be between the ages of 16 and 80. Now, how would you do that without me telling you anything else, just based on what we did with faculty and term? Yeah, though that's cumbersome, isn't it? Because it would be really hard and to list out all numbers in the range 0 to 99,999,999 as an untagged union type of positive integer values in typed racket. Even if you did wrote like another program to like actually print that out, that wouldn't be very nice to paste into your program.
I would assume you wouldn't create one of those macros.
Exactly. Yeah, that's where I'm going with this. Yeah. So, okay, so I want to show you...
Sorry, in some languages you can just specify a range, but that wouldn't work in
Yeah, so like in Ada, for instance, I believe you can have range types. You could say, you could define a type in Ada, for example, saying type age is in the range 16 to 80, type ID is in the range 16 to 99,999,999. But in Racket, we can add that feature with macros, like effectively create range types like we do in Ada. And so what I want to do is show you how to do that. So we can create macros, and macro expansion takes place before type checking and type racket, so that's fine. So we define this syntax rule, and we'll call it define range type. First, let's actually just create like what we want our range type for age to look like in ID. So we want it to be able to type define range type age 1680, like the age is in the range 16 and 80. And we want ID to be in the range 0 to 99,999,999. And we define a syntax rule saying that where we say we start by saying define range type and then some syntax object and then say match on the syntax object, pattern match on it. And in the case that the person says define range type, some type name, a lower bound on the range and an upper bound on the range, then we effectively, what we do is we want to start by actually creating syntax that says define type age and actually print the syntax union 16 and then list out all the numbers 16, 17, 18, dot, 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 80, close parentheses. Like we want to actually print that syntax before type checking occurs. Now, a range function isn't available when macro expansion occurs. It's like, I think there's different phases to how Racket programs are macro expanded, type checked, and whatnot before they run. And range isn't available at phase one, so we have to actually create a range function.
Question, when I'm typing along with you, for the let rack, it's putting me at the same place as the left-hand bracket.
The left-hand bracket. Is that?
Let rec is aligning when I type.
Oh, my bad. I think I missed. No, wait. One sec. yeah, I have to put. I'm not sure why it's aligning. Just give it, like, maybe if we.
Well, now it's. He hadn't closed the square bracket.
I think maybe once I close all of my parentheses, that won't be an issue. Yeah. So syntax case lets you pattern match on the syntax object, which we want in this case to be make it so you provide a type name, a lower bound, and an upper bound. And then if you give it this valid syntax, then you can actually, like, we want to be able to actually print the syntax defined type, a like the actual type name that you provided, the actual, like, and then the union, we want the type to be the union of all integers in the range from the lower bound to the upper bound, and actually print it out, and then give you that syntax object back, and actually insert that into your program before type checking occurs, because we can expand macros before type checking in type racket. Yeah. If you're asking about the actual mechanics about how the macro system works, the type racket and type racket. That's a little bit more involved, but there's a manual. Like, for the sake of this example, please just, like, follow along. Yeah. Okay, and then after we have our let rec and we have our range function, we want to use something called CASI syntax that will allow us to print, actually compute a range and list a range, like actually make a range which is a list of integers. And then take that list and just print out, like, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, whatnot. If you're familiar with, like, string interpolation and whatnot in some programming languages, that's kind of how this works, but with syntax, yeah. So we want to actually to print define type, our actual type name. We want it to actually write union. And then we use unsyntax splicing. There are shorthand rules for, like, syntax splicing and quasi syntax, but I don't like using those because I don't think it makes it as clear as to what's actually going on.
So unsyntax splicing is the backhaul that.
Yeah. Oh, my bad.
Is this where you would add operations?
Sorry?
What about if you want to add comparison between two IDs? You define this
Yeah.
Can you define comparison on the range type?
What's
like lower than, greater than, equal?
Sure, I don't think we need to. Oh, you mean I want a type that, say, is it has to be less than 3 or greater than 5, but not in between?
No, just like if you have this value, can you compare it? Is it like a normal integer plus some constraint?
I'm not sure. I think, like, you could do some sort of comparison here before you unsyntax splice inside this macro, but we don't need to do that for any. Yeah.
Like, for example, if you have 1 to 4 and 1 to 4, if you add them together, then you have 2 to 8, like the range kind of augment.
I'm not sure.
Because the operation, like, have some effect on the types, and, like, for comparison, it's pretty easy to do it. But, like, for addition, for example, you have to, like, change the
Do you mean define operations of type, like be able to add to range types, or? I'm not sure. That's something that would be worth looking into, but I haven't thought about that. Yeah. you could take the union of two range types, and that would be fine. If you had two ranges, you could actually just union them, and then it would be any values within that range. So as I said, if you want to, if one range is 0 to 3 and the other is 5 to 7, yeah, you could just union those types, and that would be fine. Yeah, it would be the union of those ranges, yeah.
Where to add this operation, like in the code? Where would I add the...
To union two range types?
Yeah, all right, just addition.
So, like, do you want to take the, like... define a type like foo and say it's the union of age and ID, for example, or?
Just to add like addition to the type.
Yeah.
Could you be more, I'm just not following what.
Okay, so you have defined range type age. Mm. And what if you want to compare an age?
That say that one age is less than the, I mean, I guess you could, yes, you could.
If you want to.
You mean like compute?
You need some comparison operator.
Yeah, I don't think you can like, you might be able to make like some sort of. Sorry.
How are the elements of that range typed? Because so age, there's kind of an assumption here that it's between an integer between 16 and 80, but I don't see where that integral constraint is enforced.
Just let me run this program and.
The macro is going to expand also out to all integers between your lower bound and your upper bound, mm-hmm. And that's going to inject basically after the macro expands. So it's going to say your age can only be this number or this number or this number or this number.
Yeah. Another thing, is your range function defined properly? Because in the cons call, range is taking two arguments. It looks like
I might need to fix that one sec, yeah. Can you see this? Do you want me to zoom out?
No.
No, just slowing down.
When you're changing stuff, don't, before you move on, might ask if we have it.
Mm-hmm. You're having trouble keeping up. Datum and syntax. That presumably interprets that the AST, which is the lower bound, in order to get you a value that you can evaluate in your range function.
Sorry, could you repeat that?
Where you're calling syntax datum and syntax lower bound, that seems like that has to actually interpret the I'm assuming that lower bound, as it's passed into our defined case, or as we obtain it from our defined case, is a chunk of syntax tree.
Yeah.
Is that correct?
We originally get a syntax object. We have to...
So we have to interpret that syntax object in order to get an integral value.
Yeah, at some point we have to actually convert that back to values to compute the range and create a list, which is the range. And then unsyntax place like lists out the numbers in that range, okay. In syntax, yeah. Rather than making it a list, like it unsyntax placing, we actually have to compute that list, and then it takes the like list and just lists it out as syntax, like prints it, yeah.
Right. So syntax datum called with the syntax of lower bound, it essentially interprets that.
It turns it back to like a value, so we can actually compute the range before, yeah. I'm not sure. I'm not familiar with Common Lisp. I know that Racket's macro system focuses on safety and making it sure that your macros are hygienic. And I don't know if eval is somehow unsafe in that sense. Yeah.
Okay.
run into the problem where you got out of memory when you used
the... I think that's because, yeah, when we have a union type that's explicitly union of 0 to 999,999, we run into that problem.
I figured you were going to run into that problem.
Yeah.
So obviously, the larger these fixed unions get, it's going to require more memory, but obviously, we would sometimes...
I think you can increase the memory limit. I don't think you can, like, enforce constraints about constraints. Your just program wouldn't, like, type check. It wouldn't, like, finish macro expanding, and it wouldn't type check if you, like, try to create, like, an infinite type. Yeah?
So the only way for us to define a new set of integers would be through union.
Yeah. Yeah, so that's the idea. Like, if we could have a contracts for these student and untyped bracket, and we could define a predicate saying, like, valid ID, and it has to be in this range, and that would be easy. You just check at runtime. You wouldn't have any issues. You couldn't enforce a constraint before your program runs, so your program could fail. Like, but you know where it fails with contracts as opposed to just passing around invalid students without contracts. But you wouldn't run into that issue. But in order to enforce the constraints for students at compile time, like, this is what I believe you have to do. You have to create this range type, be able to define range types and specify the range, and then let ages in this range, IDs in that range, and then enforce that. That's what you need to do to enforce this constraint.
Just to be clear, then, you could never have a type with an infinite number of inhabitants.
No, it's just like you wouldn't ever like get past macro expansion and type check. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, you have. We'll get to that after this example. I was just going in that direction. Yeah.
Just to be clear, positive. You can type something as a positive integer, right?
You what?
You can type something as a positive integer.
Oh yeah. So you could say that ID is any valid positive integer and age is any positive integer.
But that's a special case.
That's a built-in numeric type. You can't say like even.
You couldn't have implemented positive integer. Correct.
I don't believe I can actually create positive integer as a type. That's like something to do with how Racket is implemented in C, yeah. And you couldn't have types for like infinite even integers. You couldn't have like a Fibonacci number type, yeah. Okay, so let's say that it actually 1 to 1,000 actually is actually a valid ID for the sake of this example. Okay, so that's fine. So we can't now, for instance, create an invalid student. We can't say that their ID is -12, that their age is, that their name is John, that their age is 100, that their faculty, we give them a valid faculty and a valid term, but if we try to create this student now, we get a type error. So like, you can't create invalid students and have your program's type check. In the interpreter here, like it's type checking like before, like at each line that you type into the interpreter, just like how you'd use this Scala REPL or something like that, if you're familiar with that. But you couldn't create like invalid students anywhere in your program before it runs. It wouldn't type check now. Yeah. So that's that example. Okay. Now, what I want to do next is show you how to create a type for the piano numbers using structs, record types and type racket, and then go on and show how you do it with recursive types as well. Type racket supports recursive types, but they're kind of functionally the same as if you just kind of defined, for instance, in this case, piano numbers, how you would in Scala with, like, for instance, as with case classes and subtyping. One way you could do it, yeah. So, you could create a struct for nat, a struct for 0, which is a subtype of nat, a struct for s, which is a subtype of nat, and takes a n, which is a nat, which is its predecessor. And this would be like functionally the same as how you'd say that a NAT is either Z or the zero or the successor of NAT in a programming language that supports algebraic data types like Haskell. Sorry.
Just kind of closing parens on your SNAT struct.
Yeah. So this is fine. This is similar to how you might create NATs with case classes in Scala and subtyping.
Is there a keyboard shortcut for run so we don't have to use the mouse to?
I'm thinking there is. Run is
command
R, yeah.
Excellent. Okay. Thank you.
Yeah. Okay. So you could say that you could, for instance, create zero, which is a subtype of NAT here. You can create the successor of of zero, which would be, say, two in this case. But we run into this problem where oftentimes you just want to say that zero is a NAT, but it's a variant of NAT, and you don't always just want it to have the type NAT. Or you could say that successor of zero is a NAT, but you always want it to create you always want it to be treated as the NAT type. And that so the successor of some natural number and zero are just variants of that type. You'd always just want it to be type when you're creating functions that use NATs. And you wouldn't ever want to create a function that produces, or you might in some cases, but oftentimes you'd want to create a function that just gives you a NAT or takes a NAT and gives you a NAT rather than zero and the successor of NAT. And so oftentimes because of subtyping subtyping gets in the way of typer inference here. That's my point. Like if you just type Z, then because you have subtyping, it will infer that Z is the type here and not being a subtype of NAT and not NAT here, that this example here is also just some successor type rather than, which is a subtype of NAT rather than NAT. So you have to explicitly annotate types and type bracket in many cases. So you'd have to explicitly annotate that this is a NAT, that zero is a NAT somewhere in like functions that are using natural numbers, yeah, using your piano numbers, yeah. You're right, I don't guard here, even though you can, I believe, yeah.
So somebody could go and say, oh, I add another P NAT to the NATs. And then
yeah, so like you can guard structs and type brackets saying that this can't be subtyped. But I wasn't going to go there for the sake of this example, but you're right, yeah. Or my bad, maybe I don't have the syntax quite right, but yeah, you can add a guard so that you can't subtype NAT outside of this module, yeah?
Okay. I'm a little confused about the struct syntax, where you go struct NAT. NAT is the name of the struct, and the open-close paren is saying what?
So what you're saying here is we want to be able to have a type, and we want to say that a natural number is either zero or the successor of some natural number. And to do that, we need to first create a struct for NAT, which is like the, and then extend NAT and create zero. And then also have another subtype of NAT, which is the successor of some natural number, which is effectively saying that a natural number is either zero or the successor of some natural number. That's what we need to do to have this functionality in type bracket. Yeah.
I'm just confused by the initial line that says NAT is a struct with no elements.
Yeah, it's just a struct that takes no fields, yeah.
Okay. So you can create a value of just NAT, right? You don't have to create either zero or suck. You can just type, open paren NAT, close paren, and you get the bottom NAT or whatever it is.
Okay.
You're right. I might even want to be more precise by enforcing the constraint that perhaps you can actually create a NAT, but you can create either zero or successor, some natural number, yeah? Yeah. Okay. So we talked about record types and typed racket. Let's talk about parametric polymorphism in typed racket. You can have types and record types that take another type as a parameter to construct a new type. How many of you are familiar with the example of an option data type in Haskell or perhaps Scala? It's either you have an option type that's either is either sum of some type or it's nothing. It takes, for instance, you can have an option integer. It's either contains an integer or there's nothing there. And so to do this, we can use record types to create a struct for the none case. And then we can create a struct for the sum case. And here's where we take the type parameter, in this case, A, which could be you give it some type, you create sum, and you put A inside of it, some value of type A inside of it. And then we define a type called option that's the either sum or it's either none or sum of some or sum of A. You parameterize the option type here too. Now, if you go back, you could create a type for nat that's the union of z or sum of a, where a always has to be a natural number, with using define type instead of having a struct for nat and then subtyping it.
The second line where you define sum, sum is the name of the structure, so the syntax in this case for struct has the type parameter before the name?
Yeah, that's the syntax in type racket, yeah. And we want to effectively create what you might see as option in, say, Haskell, which would be an algebraic data type. An option is either none or it's sum of A. And that's how we effectively create this functionality in type racket. Run this code. You could, for instance, create sum of integer. Or an option of integers. Oh, my bad. I think I should put the type instead. Yeah, and so we can give option the type parameter integer to create the type that's either none or sum of integer.
So this, maybe I'm jumping ahead, but the obvious question now is, can you create higher kind of type?
There's no support for higher kind of types in type racket, which is one of my remarks that I think it'd be nice to try to add higher kind of types to type racket. Where I'm going with this is I want to show you how you might add algebraic data types to type racket in a sense, just like how we created the syntax, how we made it so in some sense we can add range types to type racket. How might we define syntax so you can create algebraic data types where you just say define data type option A, which is either none or sum of A, and it creates these structs for you and does all the subtyping and guarding and whatnot, and then actually creates an option-specific pattern matching construct. So you can say instead of using match to match on these structures, you might have some function that it takes an option, and if you give it sum of some type, do this, or if it's none, do that. You can use Racket's pattern matching construct called match to destructure your option, but that's not safe in the sense that you can't provide full case coverage at compile time. You could have a function that only handles the sum of A case, and then if you give it none at runtime, it fails. And so we want to, when we create these add algebraic data types to type Racket, we want to both make it easier to define data types like this so you don't have to define structs. You just say define data type option is either none or sum of A, similar to how you would in Haskell, but also give you compile time case coverage by creating this type case construct behind the scenes where you can say type case option, my option, and then if you don't provide case coverage for both the sum of A case or the none case, then you don't type check. Yeah. Yeah. Now, as an exercise, you might be familiar with the either data type in, say, Haskell, which is either the left of A or the right of A. Based on what I just showed you for defining an option type in typed racket, how would you define either?
So
Using structs.
You do a left and a right that would be similar to sum, passing in a type, and then you define an either of A and B, and you pass those in.
Yeah, it's a union. You define left and right, and then either is the union of some. Like, you'd be, I'll just show you the answer. Yeah, you.
I'm not sure I understand the example. What is the meaning of left of A and right of B?
So an either data type lets you, for instance, create types where you can either have some, it allows you to branch but express how you're branching the types. Like, you'd either have, like, say you complete some request and the result is either a successful transaction, which would be left, or some error, which would be right, and then you might make some decisions in your software based on whether or not you have one result from the result of a transaction or the other. But express that in your types before your programs run. That would be the application of that. Yeah. So you'd create a struct for left, which takes some type A and a value of that type A, and a struct for right, which takes some type B and a value of type B, and then you define the either type, which takes two type parameters, A and B, and it's the union of either left of A or right of B. Yeah, so for example, we could say, what's the type of either string or error? I'm sorry,
Could you just say that right is a left? I mean, it's...
Like alias right to left?
Yeah, alias right to left.
I don't think it creates a new type. Aliases are just like, it would just expand to left.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Oh, so you have to be explicit.
It's not like a new type, yeah. Right. It's an alias, yeah.
In the definition of right, that would have used A instead of B, and it would all still work, right?
Except that you could say both. Call the parameter A here when you define left as a struct, and call it A here for right. But you couldn't say define type either A and A.
Yeah.
You're just saying that.
But
it's
up there on the right,
there
is no connection between that B and this B here.
Yeah, it's unbound when you're just creating the struct. But it's like you can't have two A's in either. Yeah.
I'm confused by what it means to take a struct. That's providing the parameter. All you're saying when you say left, in parentheses, left A, you're just saying it's a left parameterized by A?
Yeah. This struct needs to take a type as a parameter to construct a type. Like just a left of A isn't a type. It's a type constructor, and you have to give it a type to create a type. Yeah.
All right.
Oh, yes? Yeah, you're creating a type. You're just so that you can create functions with that either type.
Okay. And is the type expression right after the either A, B, is that something, when you type colon type, that's the exact same syntax?
I'm sorry, so you mean in the define type?
When you have define type either A, B, and then, so either A, B is creating a binding, and then you have this expression that starts with U.
Yeah, you're aliasing either A, B to... I have two type parameters for this union type of left, which takes a type parameter, and right, which takes a type parameter. Now, I don't think you can just have, like...
I mean, define type is a macro.
Yeah, define type is a type alias. You're just assigning a name. Like, actually, like, you don't have... Like, see, if we print the type of either string or error, it's just the union of right, error, and left of string. Like, there's no... It's not, like, a new type. It's just the union of right of error and left of string. It's just a name for that. It's an alias. Okay, and you can also have functions that take type parameters in racket too. For example, you can, in untyped racket, say we had a chunk function which takes some list and a number. So if you had a list of, say, nine integers, or if you have a list of nine items and you wanted to chunk it into three, it would give you three chunks, the first three, the second three, and the last three. If it was eight, it would give you three, three, and two. And so, and we want to type this function to be able to take a list of some type. You give it a type, so a list of, say, a list of that type that you give it, and then an integer, and then it chunks that list of the type that you gave it. So it works for all lists, yeah, lists of any type, yeah. So if we give it an empty list, we want to give back an empty list. If the length of our list is less than n, then we just want to give the remainder of the list. Like I said, if you had, you'd get 3, 3, and 2 if you gave it a list of 8 items. Otherwise, we want to take the first n elements of our list, which would be a list, and then chunk the rest. So it works like if we give it a list of 9 items, you take the first chunk, which would be 3, then you give the list of the remaining 6, and then it chunks it again, and then chunks it a last time, and then it's done. So how might we type this? As I said, you can give functions type parameters and type brackets. So you could say that for all types A, this function takes a list of that type A and an integer, or maybe I'll put this all in one line. And gives you a list of that type as a result. So our type signature, the type signature?
Yeah.
Yeah, so like our chunk function takes some type parameter. So for all types A, it takes a list it takes a list of that type as input. So if you give it an integer, then it takes a list of integers and an integer and gives you a list of integer. It like chunks your list of integers. If you give it some other type, then it chunks a list of that type. It just works for a list of all types.
Okay. So all being universal quantifier, is there an existential quantifier as well?
No, I don't think so. No. Yeah, I don't think you have existential types in type bracket. You mean sorry.
So all to me looks like saying template T and C++ or something. Is there any way to do this such that we could use A within the function? Like what if somewhere inside the function we wanted to have a let expression and we wanted to type something, we wanted to use A in that let expression?
I think it's bound to the function. So you could say a let some value of type A be this. Yeah, you can actually use the type A inside the function. Yeah, A is bound, this type is bound, this type parameter is bound throughout the function. So like the function knows about the type A if you want to use it somewhere, yeah? Yeah. Okay. So say we wanted to chunk a list of 1, 2, and 3 into pieces of 2. Then we would get, it infers that the type of this list is positive byte, so it gives you a list of positive bytes as a result. Type A here is inferred to be positive byte, but rather than giving you like a list of any, when you parameterize you say that this function takes a type parameter, it doesn't just infer any, it gives you back a list of positive bytes. That's the idea.
Can you go down one line?
Sure. Now, again, like as I said, subtyping kind of gets in the way in type brackets, so you might want to say that explicitly that you're passing it a list of integers as input. And so I think if you said that 1, 2, and 3 is a list of integers, and you want to chunk it into sizes of 2, then it gives you a list of integers as a result. So sometimes you, because of subtyping, you have to sometimes explicitly annotate what your input is. But it'll still say, it'll still infer that the type parameter A is integer, so you get a list of integers as a result instead of list of any, if you didn't have the type parameter, yeah? Okay.
What's the algorithm for the inference?
Can you show that again?
Show what, sorry?
Seed command do just time.
Oh, yeah, sorry. So I first type, after we made our chunk function, I showed that if you try to chunk list 1, 2, 3, and 2, it thinks that it infers that you're giving it a list of positive bytes. So it gives you a list of positive bytes as a result. But you might want to explicitly annotate that that list is a list of integers because you want to work with integers and not positive bytes. And so it infers that positive bytes is what you want, but that might not be what you want. And so you can have to sometimes explicitly annotate that it's a list of integers. I think that you'd rarely want to work with, if I just create a list of 1, 2, and 3, I'm thinking in integers, like you're being precise by saying it's a list of positive bytes unless you have a, if you had an element with, if you said 1, 2, 3, and 30,000, it wouldn't think it's positive bytes because like the range of positive bytes is like 0 to 255, but if you're below that range, it thinks it's being most precise by saying that you're working in with positive bytes. It is most precise. It's the most, it is, like, I guess,
so
strictly speaking, the most correct.
Precise is what I'm asking.
Because you might be working with, you would have to coerce to integers at some point if you didn't want integers. And like, if you were working with, if it inferred positive bytes and
so
you wanted integers.
One off of this list. If I take an element off this list, I can't use that in an integer position. I would have to cast the positive byte to integer.
I believe, yeah. At some point, yeah. If you don't explicitly annotate what it is before passing it to the function, yeah. Okay, so let's talk about recursive types in Typed Racket. Okay, so like some, as some people mentioned, like there are some types that are naturally defined recursively rather than using structs. I mean, you could define lists and the piano numbers using that the struct and subtyping approach that we used, but it might be more natural to, for instance, let's actually start with the example of a binary tree. Like binary tree is either like some leaf or it's a tree or it's a binary tree. So you could define this type for binary trees. You actually, since we just talked about parametric polymorphism and type bracket, give this a type parameter. We're defining a type called binary tree, which takes a type parameter A and says it's a recursive type. And we have to give that recursive type a name here to be able to recurse on it. We'll just call it what we're recursing on BT for binary tree. You can actually just call it binary tree too, but BT is shorter. And say it's either an A or it's a pair, a vector in this case, of A and A. So it's either a leaf or a binary tree. Oh, sorry, or it's two binary trees. It's explicit, yeah. Yeah, so for all a binary tree is either a leaf or a pair of binary trees. Now, how might you define a type for quad trees based on what I just showed you? Yeah, more things in the vector, yeah.
Or maybe make that a struct so you knew which things you were referring to. Or mm-hmm.
So are you suggesting we create a type for binary trees using structs? Or?
Oh, no, I was saying, I don't know, but if the vector gets too big, you might, if it was a struct and had names like
it might make things easier if you actually tag what the fields are, yeah? Yeah. So we define quad trees similarly by just saying that a quad tree is either A or it's a vector of four quad trees. Yeah. again, like this is a type that for all types A, you either say that a quad tree is either a leaf or a vector of four quad trees. So let's go back and look at and define the piano numbers using recursive types and typed racket. You still have to create a struct for zero. And for the successor of some natural number, what you have to do is make that struct for s take a type parameter and say that the successor of some natural number is the successor of some of one of the of that type, and then you have to define a type for the piano numbers recursively, and say that piano number is either a natural number or it's the either zero, or saying that a natural number is either zero or the successor of some natural number. Call that ZZ since we already have the. Sorry, I'll actually get rid of our definition up above. We'll open up a new file. So we've defined this type for the natural numbers using recursive type constructors and type racket. But functionally, it's the same as how we just defined it using structs and type racket. There's really no difference in terms of how it functions. It's just, I guess, it's personal preference whether or not you think it's more natural to define the piano numbers using that recursive type constructor, just use structs and subtyping. Because it's doing the same. It's still inferring, because natural numbers is either the union of Z or some natural number, even if we define that recursively, Z and S are still subtypes of nat here. We just don't say so when we define the struct, and there's no record type for or struct for nat. So you still have to explicitly annotate these z and the successor of some natural number in many cases, if subtyping gets in the way of type inference. Okay. But let's define a function that that uses this type for the natural numbers that we defined using recursive type constructors. Let's create a function that takes a nat and gives you a number. So it goes from our inductive definition of the natural numbers, piano numbers, to a number type, an instance of number in racket. So it takes some natural number n. And now I'll introduce racket's pattern matching construct. So we actually destructure our natural number that we pass as input. When converting it to a number. And I'll show how you can't provide full case coverage here. We could leave out the case where we have zero and we want to convert zero to the number zero, zero in the natural numbers to the racket's numeric zero. And how if you leave that case out, we can't provide full case coverage at compile time, and we can have a runtime error in our program and cause it to fail. So if we match on n, to provide full case coverage, we'd say, we'll call it nat, actually. And it's either the successor of n some natural number. And in that case, we want to add one to nat that its predecessor converted to a number. Or if we have zero, we want to produce the numeric number in typed racket zero.
Should that be n minus one? Is the recursive call?
It is, because if it's the successor of n is one more than n, yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah. And we can type annotate this function by saying that nat to number takes our recursively defined natural number type and gives you a number. For instance, nat to number of zero. Oh, sorry, we have to give it a nat.
Sorry, nat to number is just a symbol that the
the arrow has no meaning, it's just the name of the function?
Yeah, nat to number is the name of the function, and you can use that symbol in function names and in all identifier names in type racket, yeah. Okay. In racket, yeah. So for instance, like nat to number of 0 is the numeric number 0. The successor of the successor of 0 is 2. But we can do things like leave out the case where we handle 0 and give you 0, which would be a mistake. But match doesn't give us compile time case coverage for our recursively defined natural numbers typed in type racket. So if I try to take the nat number z now, there's no case for that, so we can't provide coverage before our program runs. With algebraic data types in what algebraic data types should be like in programming languages like Haskell is they should provide compile time case coverage. So any function that you use that you make decisions by pattern matching on that structure, you should have to provide full case coverage or else your program won't type check or compile. Yeah. And that's what we want, but we can't do that using match in type racket. Okay. And where I'm going with this is how you might add algebraic data types to typed racket and provide compile time case coverage with this type case construct, which is stronger than match.
How do you do it with if or com?
You can't destructure a nat with cond. You can only do predicate tests. Untyped racket, yeah.
For example, if you have a con boolean and then it returns a, the else case should also return a. Do you check for this type rule?
You'd get a runtime error if you didn't handle a case. Like if you just had one case in cond and you needed two, for some reason, yeah, it would just be a run. Yeah, you can't provide static coverage for that either. I'm sorry, so what we want to be able to do is we know that a natural number, our representation of the natural numbers is either z or the successor of some natural number, and we want to handle both the z case and the successor of n case, and if we miss a case, we want to be able to make it so that we can't run our program. Yeah.
More generally, this is like type inference rules. So I was thinking of the if case because it's the more easy to play with it. Mm-hmm. And what about the if case? If a condition returns some type A, else return some type A again. This is some kind of type inference rule.
That's where I'm going right now. So lastly, the last big feature of Racket's type system, which has been put into Racket's type system to accommodate the style in which you'd program an untyped racket, where untyped racket programmers like to do cond and then predicate tests inside your cond, make decisions if your input to some function is a string, then do this, and if it's a number, then do that. Is called occurrence typing, and if you had say some function foo that you can give it either a string or an any. And if you give it a string, if string or any is a string, then give you the string length of string or any. Else just give you an error. Then with occurrence typing, you can say that the type signature of this function foo is either you give it either a string or an any, the union of string any, which I guess in this case which would just be any, because any is the top type, and it gives you either a string, it either gives you an integer or error. So if you give foo 3, it gives you an error, but if you give it success, it gives you 7, the length of success, and that's occurrence typing in type.
Or error? Yeah, it's giving an error. No, it's the type. It's reading. Oh, yeah.
So do you have a question?
Sorry, why did the success? Oh wait, sorry, I did give you the thing that you.
Okay, so we've discussed the basic features of we went over the features of type rackets, type system, and talked about how we'd type annotate previous examples of untyped racket code. But one thing that's cool about type racket, as I mentioned, is that you can modify previously untyped racket. The idea is that you should be able to modify previously untyped racket code as little as possible and have it use it in type racket and have it type check it. Type racket inferring types wherever possible. And so if you go on the racket homepage and look at their example programs in untyped racket, in many cases you can actually just change the language from racket to typed racket and it will run. It'll type check and run. It'll infer what the type of this expression is. And that's the idea. Yeah, you can explicit like if you, yeah, you can explicit you can require typed and untyped racket module, and then say what the type signatures of every function that you want to use from that module is. Though there's efforts to type annotate untyped racket modules that people actually want to use and do use, that they're fully typed. It's a typed version of that racket module. In many cases, shipped with type racket. For example, there's you have like the JSON library in untyped racket for working with JSON objects for one reason or another. There's already typed JSON, and I believe, and for as an example. But for instance, in teaching, people use the How to Design Programs module, which gives you a bunch of functions and tools for creating shapes and sort of introducing racket to students through pictures. That's not typed yet, but somebody's been working on typing that in their own like their own repository. But it's not like in typed racket yet. Yeah.
A question just to history. I know Clojure has type Clojure, and I know they use basically the same system. Which one was first, racket or Clojure?
I'm under the impression, to the best of my knowledge, that typed racket came first. Like the design and implementation of type scheme is sort of a paper that came from Northeastern University, like the guy who works there who works on type racket. Like I don't know enough about type Clojure to give you a mature answer to that question, though I see from what I do know that type Clojure uses these ideas of like adding occurrence typing to type Clojure. So Clojure programmers might make decisions by doing predicate tests in the body of their definitions too. And like in the typed scheme paper written from Northeastern University, they introduced the idea of occurrence typing in that paper. That's like their original idea. So I'm assuming that type Clojure is founded on the ideas introduced in the typed scheme paper in 2006, I believe. Yeah. Yeah. Okay. And so the last thing I wanted to talk to you about is how you might add algebraic data types to type racket. So we saw how we could create these data types for option and either and our piano numbers in typed racket. That was rather awkward to do so, and we couldn't provide compile time case coverage for functions that make decisions by like destructuring our piano numbers, option and either. It was awkward to define. As you mentioned, we actually want to guard our, say, natural numbers, Z and successor, so you can't subtape it after defining it. And so we want something to do that for us. Like, ideally, we want to be...
Can you do a nickel definition of algebraic data type so I know what we're...
An algebraic data type is like a tagged... It's where you... It's like where you can either have product types or... tagged union types in the definition of your algebraic data type, so you can have like this algebraic data types is x and y. It's a product of two integers. Like it's either an integer or and then you can have unions say it's either both an integer and an integer for like a coordinate, or it's the sum tag of a string. Like you have to tag your unions. You can either have products or unions in type algebraic data types, but you have to tag your unions. So just like for option, for example, like we want to tag some or none. Instead of just having the union of nothing, which would have no tag, or just A, if we didn't have tags, then we'd just be able to say that it's A. We wouldn't be able to express that it either has nothing or it's sum of A. What's really going on behind the scenes is just what we did with structs. Like, yeah. That's what it is. It's actually just the same, though it's a kind of a nicer way to express that, yeah? So we want to be able to like say define data type nat, which is either the successor of a natural number or z, rather than jumping through the hoops that we jump through to make structs to create our representation of the natural numbers. And we want to be able to say define our nat to number function again that takes a natural number and gives you a number. But this time we want to enforce full compile time case coverage by, so if we give it some number nat, rather than using match, we want to be safer by having this type case construct where we say we're doing a type case on a nat, and we give it our natural number nat, and if we give it the successor of n, we want to add 1 to the natural number nat to number of its predecessor, and if it's z, we want it to be 0. Now Andrew Kent, who's a graduate student at Indiana University, has been doing just that, adding algebraic data types to type racket to make it easier to create our types for option either and natural numbers and provide compile time case coverage. So I'll just, for the sake of time, I'll actually just show you this module here. If you import it, it creates macros for defined data type and makes it so you can, when you define a data type, it also creates a type case. It creates like type case nat, which is specific to nat. And when you say type case nat, it looks up that specific type case for nat that gives you, that enforces full time compile time case coverage for nat.
Oh yes. So what you wrote before you wrote require data type, that just doesn't work in typed racket now.
Yeah, like I'll link you to what Andrew's been working on, but this is a module that you have to install. I'll open it up now. Yeah. So if you install this module with your from the command line, like you'd use Racket's package manager, like racko package install data type, and then require data type after you've finished installing it, then you should be able to. Make sure I have the syntax correct here. My bad, I should get rid of that. Then we have like compile time case coverage for our natural nat to number function. So, oh my bad. So if we remove the case where we handle 0 here, and we try to run this won't type check. It won't let you run your program.
Didn't we get the same error before with match, though?
No, match happened at runtime. Oh. So you're able to run the program and then try to give it 0, and it would fail at runtime. And then, say, imagine some hypothetical scenario where your software would fail and a bunch of terrible things would happen because your software failed at runtime. If you have compile time case coverage for NAT, that's safer because you can't even run your program. If you try to use NAT to number anywhere in your software before it runs, you just won't be able to run it. You have to fix that first.
So we can't use type case without the ADT package.
Yeah, you need to install data type. Yeah.
Sorry, can you tell us again where is that on?
Yeah. So do RACO package install data type.
Oh, just from the command line.
Mm-hmm.
RACO.
Oh.
Sorry, from a shell command line or from?
Yeah, I think you might be able to do it in Dr. Racket too.
Okay. It doesn't look like I have it.
Yeah, if you don't have it on your path, then it won't work.
From file, you can install package.
From file, yeah, install package. Can you install data type from there? Yeah, so you can install data type right inside Docker Racket.
Right.
Yeah. Okay, so we went over some basic features of Typed Racket's type system, saw how Typed Racket equips its type system with features that try to accommodate the style with that you program an untyped racket to make minimize friction when you're going from untyped racket to typed racket. But I also show you how we might want to endow Typed Racket's type system with some additional features that such as range types and algebraic data types that make it easier to enforce certain constraints that we might have in our software specifications, and for instance, provide compile time case coverage when we're pattern matching on these data types that we define, rather than having the possibility of missing a case and having our software fail at runtime. As somebody mentioned, I think it'd be great if we could explore adding higher kind of types to type racket, be able to carry side effects that our functions have and with types. Saying that this function has some sort of IO action and whatnot. Andrew, the same guy who worked on the algebraic data types package, is also working on dependently typed racket, exploring dependent types in typed racket. I think it's going to be an icky situation if we're just stapling a dependently typed type system onto untyped racket. If we try to accommodate the style in which you program an untyped racket and then have dependent types stapled onto that, I think that's asking for hypothetically bad things to happen. I'm thinking something along the lines of having a lot of situations where you have undecidable type checking or weird things like that. I don't know because we haven't it's not really finished yet and we haven't. I'd prefer to create a language within Racket because you can have your own languages that. You could create dependent racket and have a dependently typed programming language with S expression syntax, and you don't have to accommodate the style in which you'd program in an untyped racket. You can just have this toy language within racket. You'd say pound lang dependent racket and just play with that, and that'd be great. But I don't think we should try to accommodate the style in which you'd program in an untyped racket if we're going in that direction. It'd be a great teaching language to have dependent racket, but we shouldn't try to staple it on. It just should be a different teaching language that you use at some module in a course. All right, thank you. Any concluding questions before we wrap up?